we know that the president Hello. Is meeting with the EU President Juncker in about an hour. What do we need to see out of this meeting? What do you expect?
Well, here's what I hope we would see. I would hope we would see working with our allies to come together to forge some relationships with a strong economic opportunity with the EU and the United States to actually counter China rather than just retaliatory tariffs with our own allies. So I hope there's some agreement to lower tariffs. There's rumors there's going to be some offers of lowering tariffs on automobiles, for instance. That's a sign in the right direction. But the Europeans have other behind-the-border scenes, the issues that have negated trade in digital space, for instance. So we've got our own issues with the Europeans, but we also have an opportunity to come together to go against the Chinese, which is the biggest manipulator of trade in the world.
President Trump has talked about eliminating all tariffs, barriers, and subsidies. How would that sit with your constituents in your state?
Well, it would be good. We have a lot of agriculture in Minnesota. We have high-valued manufacturing, so lowering tariffs is good, and that broad leveling the playing field would be a good thing. Tariffs are taxes. It impacts consumers, and right now, that's what I don't like about the president's tariff policy, is we're seeing an escalation with retaliatory measures that is hurting manufacturing, that is hurting agriculture. We have a lot of food that is exported, for instance, to Canada, to Mexico, and those are our allies, so I want to see NAFTA come to a conclusion as well.
So, Congressman, let's talk about agriculture a little bit. In a hearing with Representative Lighthizer, Trade Representative Lighthizer, you said let's not shoot ourselves in the foot. Are we in the process, in your judgment, of shooting ourselves in the foot? Because it sure looks like we're going to be curtailing exports of agricultural products.
Well, we shouldn't be shooting ourselves in the foot because Minnesota is an agriculture state. We export a lot of soybeans, pork producers, corn, for instance. So it's kind of the tip of the spear. And with commodity prices already being depressed, I'm worried that we're going to negate the benefits of tax reform, which has actually been a big boon to our economy right now. And so trade uncertainty kind of creates a little bit more skepticism or uncertainty for those who want to invest in new projects, pipelines, agriculture as well, making sure that's going to move forward. And those markets can be lost to other countries if we're not careful.
Congressman, I think that the president, if he were here, would say, look, we have to have some pain in order to accomplish a much bigger goal here, which is to really reform our trading relations. How much pain are you and your constituents in Minnesota willing to endure before you really say, we got to change course?
Yeah, I don't think it's a question. I think the president's misguided in terms of we can take some pain. I think the approach should be, what can we do with Canada, with Mexico, and with the European Union, acknowledging that China does have some very unfair trade practices and is an abuser, and we should be working with our allies. But instead, we're inflicting pain on ourselves by challenging our allies. And so that's where I think the tariff policy is misguided. That's where I think the president's wrong. And hopefully, some of the meetings that are happening now, and I think the opportunity, what President Trump should do, is sit down with President Xi in China to move this forward. A summit at that level could break the logjam.
And yet, for now, President Trump is just announcing more subsidies for farmers. We know that he'll be giving out $12 billion. Wouldn't that just add more to the deficit? How concerning is this?
Yeah, I think that's just the wrong approach. We should be focusing on the issue itself for a long-term, durable solution. So just doing more ag subsidies, just doing more tariff on retaliatory measures, that's not the right approach. I don't agree with that approach, and that's the message I'm going to continue to convey to the White House. In fact, this afternoon, we will be meeting, some of us on the Ways and Means Committee, will be meeting with Peter Navarro, who is one of the trade economic advisors in the White House, to convey that message.
On deficit concerns, we know that you just passed a bill to repeal the medical tax 2.3%, right. But we're expecting that to reduce federal revenue by about $22 billion over a decade. Why doesn't the deficit concern you here?
Well, real quick, so the medical device tax is 2.3% excise tax on all medical devices. It was a tax put on as a part of Obamacare. We had a strong vote yesterday in the House to repeal it, to eliminate it. And that's because since the tax was put in place, we lost 29,000 jobs in this sector. It's a big American success story. These are high-valued, high-paying wages that bring life-saving, life-improving technologies to the United States, and we're a global leader in this area. So bipartisan support to get rid of a bad policy. And just a reminder, it's not a tax on profits. It's been a tax on sales. So this is really a small measure, won't have any impact in terms of overall spending or the deficit compared to the jobs we've lost.
What's the potential effect, Congressman, on the overall Affordable Care Act? And where do you stand on that? Because after all, Minnesota is the home of Mayo Clinic. And the idea was to have more people covered by insurance so they get better health care.
Yeah, well, we didn't see the benefits of the Affordable Care Act as much as was championed or talked about. It's helped some people, but it's hurt more people, unfortunately. And Minnesota was a state, whether it was the Mayo Clinic or the University of Minnesota, where we had lowered our uninsured rates and actually had been doing things really smart and strategic and well on a statewide basis. But then that kind of got overrun with a one-size-fits-all approach. So I'm more of a fan of letting states attend to their own population needs as they best see fit. And there are things we can do better. We can keep some provisions, like people covered under age 26 on their parents' policy, covering pre-existing conditions. But at the same time, we've got to lower premiums because these high deductibles now have put people in a position where they don't even have insurance right now. And that's the unfortunate mishap we've had with the Affordable Care Act so far.
So finally, Congressman, give us an overall picture of the relationship between the Republicans up on the Hill with this administration. We expect the Democrats to be against a lot, if not all, of what the administration wants to do. But is this administration listening to you and to your colleagues who are Republicans? Do you see any indication that you're altering their path in any way?
Well, I'll say this. We've had a lot of conversations about trade, which we talked about earlier, and there were some items that were put on lists, for instance, on retaliatory measures involving medical device companies. And so some of us signed letters on medical device products, consumer electronics, sent that to the White House, and the White House did remove those items from those lists. So they are listening to us, and we want to make sure we're working with a framework that's going to give a long-term solution that's durable for the long term, rather than just tariffs going back and forth. So I think those meetings are going to be ongoing. We're going to work hard to make sure we get this right so we can keep our economy moving ahead strong and not have that uncertainty on the horizon.